Welcome to Living with Valor, where we have intimate conversations and storytelling with spiritual beings who are sharing their human experience. I'm Radios Muhammad, your host, with producer P. But before we interview our next guest, let me tell you a little bit about them. This person is a Colorado herbalist who resonates with the sounds of African drums, rhythmic chanting, and Afro-Caribbean folklore. He's led various workshops and herb walks at places like Ruby Hill, Tiny Farm, and the lovely Woodbine Ecology Center. He's taught for the Denver Botanic Gardens and Herbal Certification Programs. Now he teaches for the Colorado School of Clinical Herbalism and sees patients out of his home in Englewood. He has made himself available to come to homes and Colorado residents with his holy prayer and plants to get rid of negative energy and spiritual entities that make residents feel uncomfortable. Lastly, his specialties are herbs, medical astrology, the outdoors, singing, and alternate healing methods, having been a lifelong interest for the Denver native who plans to continue to use workshops and music to teach people in herbal areas how to access the earthly medicines growing around him. He also received the Preventative Care Leadership Award from the Be Well Health Initiatives in 2019 for being of service to diverse black and brown communities. Please welcome Monticue Connally.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here. Thank you.
I kind of messed up that bio, but hey, you know, it's all good. Anyway, there's so many amazing things that you've done. Monticue, well, just so you all know, Valor family, we met. I think I attended one of your workshops in your home. That's how, and you had promoted it on Facebook. Is that correct?
Actually, I believe I met you during, the fall.
Okay.
At... and correct me if I'm wrong, but I believe it was at a blessings and banishing class. I was teaching how do we use the spiritual allies that are attached to the herbs, and start to like know when to burn this, or when to place a certain branch in your house, or whatever, to ward off spiritual vampires and other nasty entities.
And then you provided some of your saging, different sages, and different mechanisms that we can. Yes,
absolutely.
I do remember. And I remember your children were just incredibly impressive.
Thank you.
Oh my God, the questions that they asked, I was like, who thinks like that at their age? How were they at that time?
Yeah, they had to be like maybe 9 or 10, maybe something like
his
that.
His children are amazing. They are like out of this realm.
Appreciate it.
Yeah, they're in high school, right?
Yeah, they're both in high school. Mm-hmm. My son said, he said, 8th graders are immature. He said, so I'm going to skip 8th grade and go to 9th grade. I said, if you want to skip, you know there's a test. He's like, yeah. I was like, all right. And he passed the test.
Wow.
So he's a 9th grader. He skipped.
Wow.
Just because he wanted to.
And so who's the oldest?
My daughter's the older one.
So is she in 10th grade or 9th grade?
She's in 10th grade.
Wow. How does it feel?
It feels good. I like the direction, especially with my daughter being very much a leader. She's the head girl of her school.
Mm-hmm.
A school that's centered around HBCU sort of thing.
Yes.
In Green Valley.
Okay.
And so she's doing that. Head girl, cheerleader, very social, always being in the front. And I just always appreciated that, because when I was in high school, I didn't lead that way. I was just in my own zone as a Pisces.
Right.
But she's just very connected to the people. Now my son's more like me. He's at his own.
What are their astrology signs?
My son is actually an Aries.
Okay.
And my daughter's a Virgo.
Okay. My daughter's a Virgo too.
Which was very important for me and very helpful.
Yeah.
As a Pisces, with a lot of water in their chart and everything. My daughter is very grounding.
Mm-hmm.
And when my first marriage broke, she was very much still like knew where all the socks were. And things like that. My little daughter, she just needed that. Boom's over there. Orion needs this, Me and Orion are just spaced out, okay, where's this thing, So it was very helpful to have. So you never really understand why you have certain elements placed into your life until you meet them.
Right.
And so she's been a blessing. My son's a blessing too, learning a lot about him. He was actually an interesting child.
Tell me about
a super genius. He was reading at around. He was reading at a very high level. Maybe around 3, he was like at an 8th grade level reading.
What, 8th grade?
Absolutely, and it started at a very young age. He, instead of sleeping with like stuffed animals, all he wanted to do was sleep with letters. So he would say, I want my bee, I want my bee. And we'd get some construction paper and put black marker. He liked black marker.
Wow.
We put black marker on the paper and put it in his crib.
Really?
And he would sleep with the letter B. Next morning, I want to sleep with M.
Wow.
That's how he was just different around words. So I'm expecting him to at least be some kind of editor or something. He loves words. He's a word guy. You know, it's like words, English, language, codes.
A lexicologist.
You know?
Yeah. He's a lexicologist.
Yeah, absolutely. And it was funny because I used to get gigs because of that, like as a tutor.
Uh-huh.
I would say, I want my kid to be able to do that. I would say, look, I didn't do that. You know, like maybe I...
Well, her mother, when she was pregnant, because a lot of times the women formulate the mind and
their thoughts,
if they're readers or, you know.
Yeah, and she, you know, I was always teaching around them, always talking about sophisticated concepts and things like that. When he was born, I never stopped him from going to, like, the encyclopedias and things.
Mm-hmm.
And actually, when he was a baby and couldn't even understand what a word was, I would sit there, you know, he's just a little baby, and I would read to him whatever I was reading, even if it wasn't a child's book, and I would scan the words, and as a baby, he would just follow along.
Wow.
And eventually, he'd just start picking it up. But I don't want to take too much credit because, you know, because I know a lot of that's a gift, you know, the way his mind was structured around
his
education. Yeah.
Wow, maybe I have to bring him on the show.
he's not like me, though. He's not like me as far as
is
being.
Is he an introvert?
He's very introverted.
Okay.
But
your daughter's an extrovert.
My daughter's more extroverted than him. So during the whole COVID thing, he was in heaven. Being under his bed.
But we were like, I'm a Pisces too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I was like, I need connection.
I need to go out. I need people.
But also, when I look at like generational curses, like in my family, I see certain people can become a hermit in my family and just cut everybody off. And watching those generational curses, I never wanted to get lost in here. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So I feel like consciously, I always want to make it a point to have community, you know, around me, because one of my principles around even what God is that God is also community. And if you don't have a community, you don't have accountability.
Yeah.
And if you don't have accountability, your weak points can't be shown to you.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Accountability shows you, it's like, okay, hey man, I know you think you're doing this, but it's actually... You know, it's actually doing this.
And accountability is in all places. So you got to understand there's people in relationships.
Yes.
I like how you say, I really think our children choose us.
Yeah.
I don't think we choose our children. But even with relationships, we get so hung up, but we fail to realize that water seeks its own level, first of all. And relationships are all about you learning about who you are.
Usher.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So I like the way you said about accountability. But something you didn't mention, let's talk about... You know, generational curses.
Mm.
Let's talk about that. But before we hit that, roll back.
Yes.
When Monticue was little, how did you come about this path? Herbalism. Tell me, what led you in?
Herbalism.
You know, spiritualism.
Let me tell you. So I was raised in the Nation of Islam at an early age.
Yeah.
And but then we started breaking away. And things got more experimental when the mosque started falling apart when I was probably around 10 or 11 or something like that. And so all these books started coming to the house of different philosophies, different ways of looking at things. Everybody like, but we had this Nation of Islam foundation, but like started pulling and grabbing things.
Yeah.
And one of the books that found its way into my house was called African Holistic Health. Yes, and I read it. It's by Laila of Africa.
Yes!
Peace, Laila of Africa.
I got that book.
And in the book, it said, onions for a burn. Put onion on a burn. And I said, that sounds so dumb. Why would you put something hot? Because I looked at onions as being like a hot thing. You know what I mean?
It's kind of spicy.
It's kind of spicy. I was like, why would I do that? Well, one day I'm in the kitchen. I was around 16, 15. And I was talking on the phone, like, yeah, girl, you know what it is, hot to my girlfriend, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I put my hand on the stove, trying to lean, you know what I'm saying? And so I burnt my hand, and I was like, oh, my God. So I did what a lot of people do, where they go and they put their hand under the water.
Oh, no.
You know, and I put my hand under water, and then you take it off, and it's still burning.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? So what I did was, my little Africa said onion. So I went to the fridge, there was no onion in there. Looked in the cabinet, there was onion powder.
Oh.
So I grabbed the onion powder and something intuitively started speaking through me, like, just add a little water to that. I was like, okay. Mm-hmm. So I added a little bit of water and made a paste mm-hmm. out of that water. As soon as I made the paste, I started rubbing it on the burn.
Okay.
And I'm like, that didn't work. A minute and a half, about a minute to 2 minutes later, the pain was completely gone.
Wow.
And I've used this remedy for over 20 years. It's mm-hmm. the best burn remedy mm-hmm. that I've ever come across.
Okay.
And it's because onion, the spirit of the onion, the power of the onion is in its smartness. It's a smart herb.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when you're dealing with herbalism and you're dealing with herbs and their powers, there's some that are very smart and like they delegate and move things around.
Mm-hmm.
And there's others that are just pushers.
Okay.
So cayenne is hot, right? If you put that on your burn, it's going to burn.
Right.
Cayenne's like heat, heat, heat.
Mm-hmm.
Where the onion powder is like, okay, how can we distribute this heat in a good way?
Like disperse it.
Disperse it.
Okay.
Put it where it needs to go. That's why eating onions is very important
mm-hmm.
as far as inflammation and things like that. You know, but do not, if you're watching this and you see me, do not come to me and say garlic didn't work. Because I did not say garlic. I can't tell you how many people come to me and say, man, that garlic made it worse. No, garlic is gar. Onion, O-N, those are the first two letters of onion. Put onion on it, okay, if it's hard for you to remember. Onion and garlic, people get it mixed up. Let me tell you, one time my grandmother actually burned herself really bad, and I taught her this remedy.
Oh, my.
And, flame went up her arm, you know, trying to light
the gas thing.
Yes. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And so what she did was she actually, she didn't even make it a paste. She just dumped the whole onion powder in a pot of water and put her arm in there and was like, right?
Okay.
Fire department shows up.
Mm-hmm.
They said, what are you doing?
Mm-hmm.
Get that out of there. They took it out. They put this cream on her and wrapped up the arm.
Mm-hmm.
As soon as they left, she took that mug off, right back in that water.
Right.
Because that's how powerful this remedy is.
Right.
And that's how I got started. After I found out that onion powder could do that, I said, what else is out there? Because
mm-hmm.
I like that power. Power.
Did you intuitively just start on your own, or did you go learn more, like go to schooling?
Yeah, absolutely. So it's an interesting story. So
mm-hmm.
I began to ask plants what they did.
Oh,
you know?
I love that.
I started walking around. I'd see a weed, and I'd say, wait, you're not just a weed. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
You have a name.
Like
same way they do us in the streets where they say, oh, those are thugs. It's
mm-hmm.
like, no, I have a name. If you get to know me, there's a lot more going on.
I like that.
When you know the name of something and the history, you give it a history, it's a whole nother other elements can be drawn out of it.
Right.
And so I started doing that, walking around.
Mm-hmm.
And it's interesting because the universe, if you have a certain way that you're supposed to move in this life, you'll start to bump into certain teachers. And so,
yes.
I went to the club. I used to do a lot of open mic rapping and singing all the time.
Do you do poetry too?
I do a little bit of poetry too, but I'm better. I'm a better rapper, I would say. You know what I mean? Better rapper, but way better singer. Singing is my first thing.
Okay.
And so I went to this club, and I'm waiting for my turn to get on the stage and whatnot. And I noticed while everybody's drinking and, you know,
yeah.
and they're like writing down their rhymes or whatever they're working on,
yeah.
there's this one sister in the middle of the club reading a botany book. And I'm like, she was like invisible. No one's paying attention to
See,
her.
See, that's
nothing.
Something I would do.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, I would be like at a restaurant
yeah.
reading a book.
Yeah, in the middle.
I'm comfortable in my own skin.
Absolutely.
Yes.
And she, I went up to her because, you know, I like brainy folks, you know, people that are always trying to learn something. So I went over there and I was like, hey, what's going on?
I was
like, yeah, right, yeah. I was going to say that. I don't know how to keep up on that.
Yes, I am. I like smart people.
You know, right?
Yes, yes. That's a turn on for me.
Yeah, for sure. So I started talking to her.
He said words.
And I told her I was having these mystical experiences with plants already.
Okay.
You know, like, so remedies aside.
Mm-hmm.
They had already started speaking to me, you know, different things. And she was like, okay, cool. I like how you're talking.
Mm-hmm.
She definitely vetted me first. Like,
of
let me
course.
See if you're real, you know.
Yeah.
When she found out I was real, she became my first teacher. She was an expert herbalist.
Right.
Expert herbalist. She had some tradition that had been passed down to her from the Yaqui tribe,
mm-hmm.
you know. But also she had learned in school and things like that. And she said, just follow me. So I followed her for years,
mm-hmm.
you know, learning all the different plants around here, learning how to set up your cabinet,
mm-hmm.
learning all these things until that relationship broke off. And when that relationship broke off, I started going into training programs.
Okay.
But before the training programs, I was going to botanic gardens.
Mm-hmm.
Funny thing about botanic gardens is that I used to go to their herbarium and I'd just bring a bunch of weeds and be like, what's that, what's that, what's
mm-hmm.
that? And they would tell me, but eventually they started asking me, because they were all white folks.
Yeah.
And they start saying, why do you want to know this stuff? I was like, oh, because it's interesting. No, but why do you want to know it? And then they started giving me problems. Like, so the next time
you mean like preventing you from finding out information?
Yes.
And then you'll find the cure for something you're trying to take drugs on. You know?
Yeah, it was crazy because, you know, because they weren't necessarily herbalists, but they were herb specialists,
right.
You know, that like to classify and mm-hmm. things like that. And so I, one day I go up there and they said, look, if you want to keep learning this, you have to pay us $40 per plant. And I was such an enthusiast that I said, okay, I'll pay you $40 per plant that you identify for me. They said, you know what? They went and talked to the circle and came back and said, actually, we don't want you to come back.
What?
They don't want to come back. They just said they didn't like me or something.
How was that?
That was a long time ago. Because
it's not like that now.
Maybe 12 years ago, 12, 13 years ago. So, well, let me tell you how it changed. Because after I went through the apprenticeship with this young lady,
right.
After I went through several programs and became a teacher, they hired me. In the bio, yes, I was part of their first herbal certification teaching program.
There you go.
You know, as soon as they said, hey, we're opening up herbal certification training program. We want you to be one of the teachers. So I was one of the teachers. There's about four of us that were chosen out of a bunch of folks. And then COVID hit. And then so their program kind of went to the wayside and started teaching for other places. But that's kind of the journey and how it went.
Uh-huh.
You know, and even the mystical side. You know, I brought this plant here.
Yes, talk to me
about
that.
You know, this is a root.
Yes. What does it do?
And this is a root that grows here in Colorado, Ligusticum porteri.
Ligusticum porteri.
Also known as bear medicine, also known
what
as Osha. So,
Osha?
Osha. And this is,
what
like,
is
this
Osha?
This is an herb sacred to the natives, a lot of native folks.
Mm-hmm.
They use it in sweat lodges. When people get real tired at our altitude and things like that, you know, sometimes people take a little bit and bite it and chew on it,
okay.
And it make them feel stronger.
Okay.
It's very good for the digestive tract. It has a lot of things. But this herb is specifically powerful to me because it helped me with a lot of mystical issues I was having.
Okay, can I touch it?
Absolutely.
Tell me about your mystical issues.
Yeah, so when I was have you ever seen the movie The Sixth Sense?
Yes, I have.
I was like that little kid. I would see things, I'd see shadows, I had premonitions, you know, things would come into my house and talk to me and things like that. But
so you see things.
I see things,
okay.
I feel things, you know, anything that you would call folkloric or out there, I've seen it. You know, so
No, you're good.
So what I did was, you know, I'd reach out to different community members,
mm-hmm.
but my stories would scare them. You know what I mean? Like, I'm like, you're a priest, you're a pastor, right?
Yeah.
No, that's the devil, you know. Okay.
He's the devil.
You know,
I understand.
Like,
yeah.
You know, even certain people I thought were like out there were just like, bro, that's weird. That's too much for me.
Mm-hmm.
And so to make a long story short, when I took that apprenticeship with that sister,
right.
Went to the mountains, that was the first route that we dug together.
Oh.
When I brought it back to the house, some of the things that used to haunt me
mm-hmm.
stopped.
Were you afraid? Were you afraid of these, everything on the, you know, the behind the veil, the spiritual realm? Were you afraid? Like, because sometimes I've seen shadows.
Yeah.
When I was younger, I was looking, but I didn't know what I was looking for. And then as I've gotten older, like, things pick up. We went to an antique store.
Yeah.
And I bought a couple of things.
Absolutely.
And I didn't sage it.
Yes.
And something was attached.
Yes.
And it was a shadow. In my hallway,
yeah.
And then it came on the bed, and I was like, "Oh no, you got to go!
Absolutely,
you can't stay here."
Absolutely.
So I'm not afraid now,
absolutely.
But I was because I didn't understand the power. So you're saying that route helped you in
yeah.
what way? Can you elaborate on that?
So, and I'm actually working on a book about this, just to give more detail.
I got it.
You know, and there's a whole oracle system, you know, I'm working on around it. But it was very hard because I used to suffer from something called psychic attack.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of psychic attacks.
Okay, I understand.
And this was before I knew that spirits could be attached to objects.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and not having any guidance. You know, I'd bring certain things into the house, or there'd be certain things. You know, usually it's like porcelain dolls.
I don't do
sometimes
porcelain.
Stuff you get from like dolls you get from Walmart. Sometimes
mm-hmm.
like the plastic. You know,
yeah.
Things like that, or even certain creepy paintings, or like old creepy
oh, yeah.
things like carry energy.
Yeah.
But I didn't know that, so I would just suffer. I'll sleep with the light on, you know, even in my adulthood, like 20s, things like that, I'm sleeping with the light on because that was when it would dissipate more. But I don't get as much rest when I sleep in light, you know, so I had to figure this thing out. So I turn off the lights, I would have these symptoms like where I couldn't sleep, and if I did sleep, I'd be psychically attacked, so I'd wake up like, ah! You know what I mean?
I'm freaking out. I totally understand what you're saying.
And so it would be so scary because I could feel it. After you have the psychic attack, you can feel the spirit of the thing on you.
Right.
Oh, get it off me. Most people can't understand what you're going through.
No, I totally understand what you're saying.
Because adults usually grow out of this stuff. You know what I mean? Like, little kids usually be real sensitive. They're like, oh, there's something in my closet. But adults usually, but for me, I never grew out of it. So I could, and it got worse. It continuously gets more and more sensitive. And so anyway, what would happen though is, so I'd have these psychic attacks. Eventually it happened so much that I, like you said, I stopped being afraid of it. And I just faced it. And I just left the lights off. And I said, okay, yeah, you scared me. You know what I'm saying? But you do this so much, I'm going to follow and see where you're coming from.
Yeah.
And I followed it with my senses, and wow, porcelain doll. I'd take the porcelain doll and I could feel it all around it, and I would put it in the trunk of my car.
Okay.
Because what I realized is with physical objects, there's proximity.
Right.
The farther it is away from you, the less power it has.
Okay.
You know, so, and that's how I became, because, you know, now I do a lot of house blessings.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'm also what they call an artifact medium. So, like, people that have objects, they want to know, like, is this good for me or bad? You know,
yeah.
They bring it in, things like that. But going through that, it really helped me to understand how to bless and how everything can't be cleared with just a prayer, or everything can't be cleared with just, so it depends on the dimension on which the being is coming.
So for me, I was never trained about anybody. I've talked to shamans, I've talked to so many different people.
Yeah.
And it's just an innate thing. I don't even know how to do it.
Yeah.
But did you learn this intuitively, or did someone have to teach you?
Right.
Like, when my daughter was in college and she had roommates, and she said, Mom, I need you to come and cleanse our house.
Right.
And I do candle magic.
Yeah.
So I just said, okay. I prayed, I meditated. She was in Fort Collins, so I don't even know what I was coming into.
Yeah.
But there was something there, and I went through, it took me 4 hours to cleanse this house.
Yeah.
But I went to go get the candles, I knew the colors. I don't know how. I don't know. I put the stuff. I put everything. I walked through City Park. I just grabbed stuff, and I made, you know, dressed up my candle. I don't know how I did it. So I haven't. I don't know. I don't know how to. I just know it. So did you know these things intuitively, or did you have to learn them?
I had to learn them through my sensitivity, because it was so strong.
Yeah.
It was so strong. It was at, like, you just sitting here. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It wasn't like, let me try to assist. No, it's like, in my face, this worked, this didn't work.
Okay.
And it also shocked me that some people that had the most haunted houses didn't know. You know, because you can also be affected through hauntings indirectly.
Yes.
Mood swings, depression.
Yeah.
You know, feeling scattered.
Mm-hmm.
You know, nightmares.
Yes.
Things that normal people that don't feel stuff have can also be the result of hauntings in their house.
That are old energy.
Old energy.
Yeah.
So it's not just people like me that are just, oh. The difference is that I sense it directly.
Mm-hmm.
What a good example I think of is something called dust mites. You know, I'm sensitive enough to feel dust mites directly. So if I'm laying in your bed, I can feel it as small as they are.
No, I understand.
I can feel dust mites walking on me. Now, but most people can't. Most people cannot feel dust mites.
Nope.
And so the way that they experience it, though, is allergies. Like, they can sneeze dust mites. They might cough.
Mm-hmm.
You know, these things like that. And then when they do the little test, they're like, oh, you have a bunch of dust mites. You need to do this certain thing to your mattress to get them off or whatever. But same thing with spirits.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? Like, some of us feel that stuff directly.
Oh, yeah.
But the majority feel it indirectly. And so even around this time where the veil is thinning, it's Halloween and all this stuff, people are like, you need to go to a haunted house. You might already be in one.
Yeah. And that's true. When I cleanse their house, and I started from the top and went down.
Yeah.
And when I was down in that basement, and it was a finished basement, and I went into where, like, they had a water heater, and I just started crying. And I didn't know why I was crying. And then I just, you know, started saging, and I did the candle, and I did some, sound waves in there. I was in there for the most of the time. And I said, who's been in this basement? Who lived in this house? And she said, there was, I felt the entity, and I said, you got to go, or you need to stay right in that corner.
Absolutely.
And I said, keep this candle burning. Do not blow it out.
Absolutely.
And, you know, and so the girl said, I don't know what you did, but that was the first good night's sleep I've had in months. She said, I haven't slept. And now there was one room I did not touch. I went in. It was so cluttered. I don't
like,
do clutter.
I'm good, huh?
I'm OCD. I don't believe in junk drawers. I believe in, like, I just had all my couches clean, my mattress clean. And I just cannot do clutter.
Yeah.
As you can see, everything's organized.
Absolutely.
So I don't like clutter. So, but it was nasty. I went in there. I was like, oh, nope, I'm not touching. And she was always in a bad mood and nasty. So, yeah, I think that's important to understand that people don't know that also that plays a role. Old energy, you know, I just went through a breakup. As soon as the day that person left, I had someone come and sweep my house. And she said, she started in the basement. She said, was he depressed? She was like, it's good that you got this house cleaning, because a lot of times when someone leaves, you might be okay. But then a couple of days later, two or three days later, you might be upset, crying, or angry, because the energy is still lingering. So yeah, I understand exactly what you're saying. People don't even know, you know, that's why all my houses are new.
And you know, like, old is okay. It just depends on the material. There's certain materials that attract negative vibration.
Well, I'm gonna have to come get you if I have to go new.
Because, you know, there's certain woods, there's certain plants, you know, there's certain crystals, right? Like quartz is beautiful.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter if it's old.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So it depends on the material.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes it depends on where it came from.
Mm-hmm.
But I like how you're using the candles, because some people, when they think of prayer, they only think of prayer through air.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we can pray with our words.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a type of prayer.
It is.
But you can put your prayer, like your intention, onto a candle.
Yep.
Or water. That's libation.
Yes.
I mean,
water, you know, glasses of water, everything. Yes, I totally
agree.
Even
people that cook for you, they're putting that love and all that into the food. That's all intentional.
Mm-hmm.
That's all magical.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and that's why I talk about these different dimensions, you
mm-hmm.
know, like with you doing the candle, and also using the mental realm, the
mm-hmm.
intuition.
Yeah.
You're hitting multiple realms at once.
Right.
You know what I mean? And I believe that's what that woman needed in order to get the peace that you were able to bring.
Yeah.
You know? But just understanding the multidimensionality of it. And the multidimensionality of us.
Why do you think people are so afraid of this other realm? Because this is the three dimension.
Yeah.
We have a five dimension.
Yeah.
I mean, we're spiritual beings here. You know what I'm saying? We're just shelled. Why do you think people are so conflicted, and it's a fear, and they say it's evil and it's the devil? Why do you think so?
Yeah, I think we're programmed at such a young age to be, oh, this is good, this is bad. Think about it, like, when you even school, like, it's like you're being programmed over and over. I used to work at a high school, and there was this class called medical history, and I was so disgusted at this class, because all it did was put down all the old medical systems. These people only live to be 30. These people in Egypt only live to be 25. These people in China only live to be 40.
Yeah.
And then the great white so-and-so pops up.
Oh.
And now we have the modern day this and that.
Mm-mm.
It's all marketing. Mm-hmm. You know,
yeah.
It's all marketing. I think it's around the spiritual stuff, because, you know, when we look at the dominant religions of our societies, you know, that's kind of part of the game. It's like, yo, pastor didn't say it is evil. You know? I used to get in trouble at church for saying, could the Holy Spirit be the divine feminine? Get out of here! You're the devil!
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, it was automatically demonized. And so we don't know the true history about medicine in this country.
Mm-hmm.
You know, a lot of these plants, for example, dandelion, Taraxacum officinalis, anytime in the Latin name you see officinal or officinalis, means that plant was an official part of the U.S. medical pharmacopoeia. I mean, that's what doctors were using in the 1920s. What we don't know is that there were different schools of medicine.
Wow.
You know, and the one that got funded and legalized is the one we have today. The other ones died off, because now they can't say they cure things.
Yeah.
But before that, you have to understand, the one we got now, the one that's good at pulling out bullets and all that stuff and blood injections, is because that's how they started off, was cutting.
Mm-hmm.
You know, African-American captives, also known as slaves, enslaved Africans, we would not let master know when we were sick.
Yeah.
Because what he would do, you have an earache, bleed him. You got a cough, bleed him till he stops.
Wait a
minute.
Wait, okay, so that's probably why I'm so fond of bunnies. Because they're prey animals. and they're very delicate stomachs, and they will not let you know when they're sick. By the time you know they're sick, you got like a very small window to heal them.
Interesting.
And my bunny upstairs that you met, she had just ate something, and I could tell she was sick. I had a very small, I didn't know what to do. I just started grabbing stuff, and I got her to, you know, because they're constantly missing. If they're not constantly pooping and eating, there's something wrong.
That is interesting how you found an animal that kind of corresponds to that.
Yeah, and a Christian woman told me that.
That's interesting.
Yeah, because I love bunnies. I didn't know that. My eighth bunny.
You know the way to your heart. Get you some bunny stuff. Bunny t-shirt. Bunny, bunny mug. You said an actual animal. Some bunnies.
But yeah, see, it's like everybody has a spiritual animal. Do you have a spiritual animal?
Absolutely. I'm wearing a bear here, a bear here. Bear here, silver bear.
And wasn't that like bear root? Bear.
So you get a theme.
Okay.
You get a theme.
Tell me about the. And then you got a dandelion up here. Is that a dandelion? No, that's a sunflower.
That's a sunflower.
Okay. Yeah. So tell me about this spiritual animal.
So bear was one of my first nicknames my mom used to call me. Mm-hmm. It was one of my first favorite animals. It would pop up in pictures that people would take.
Okay.
You know, they'd say, "Why is there a bear?" I was like, "There was no bear there." You know, but there'd be a bear in the picture.
Like, were you hiking or something?
No. Like, literally a bear, like a shadow of a bear in the background, or like my face would look like a bear, it would always just pop up. And so the bear also would pop up in my dreams a lot when there was problems or troubles. I'm like, how am I going to get across this stream? A bear would come along, like, you know, jump on the bear. So, you know, all these started like coming together for me to realize that the bear was a big part of my medicine.
Mm-hmm.
And also, like, I started reading more about bears in my path.
Yeah.
And the bear has been a powerful symbol of herbalism and medicine for a long time, because the bear, a lot of natives would look to the bear to see what to eat.
Yeah.
There's a lot of herbs called like bear root, you know, or bear medicine or bear something.
So that's how you found your spiritual animal.
Yes. I found it through just all the synchronicities.
Yes.
You know,
the signs and everything.
All now, signs.
Producer P has a question for you.
Yes, you answered as you kept talking.
Well, absolutely.
How did you know the bear? Like, were you young when the bear came to you?
Absolutely.
Like the
what age?
Just started appearing out of nowhere.
Yeah, it just started appearing. I could remember maybe about 3 years old. You know what I mean? But I started remembering, and I remember my mom would call me Bear, and I'd say, "Mom, why are you calling me that? My name's Monticue." You know, like, it doesn't even, I'm not Mary or whatever. She's like, "I don't know, you're just my little bear." You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like,
have you had any connections with bears?
And the other thing is, I don't even, it's deeper than like a logical thing, because I don't necessarily look at a bear and say, "Oh, wow, cool bear." You know what I mean?
Okay.
It's spiritual, it's like automatic.
Yeah.
It's like, "Oh, that's mine." You know what I mean? Just like the color green. You know, like, sort of certain things that just come to you.
So how do you, like, so my friend Nate, he's into the same thing. He found his spirit sign was a peacock. So, like, is it just something you just happen to just see?
Yeah, that was my question.
Now,
good question.
My opinion is this, that we have multiple animals.
Yes.
But that we have a lead animal.
Mm-hmm.
The bear is definitely my lead. It's the head.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so you might come across other animals, you know, but with the peacock, you know, there's a lot of things around beauty, how you show up, pride, you know, what are these themes around the peacock? And also the peacock is cool because it can lead you a little bit into some African spirituality too, because the goddess Oshun, you know, chose the peacock as one of her representations.
Yeah.
She's the goddess of beauty, ego, and all these things.
Yeah.
And so it could take you further into like their ancestry too. But yes, you know, paying attention to the multidimensionality that we are, you know, ultimately will lead you to also your power animals, power plants, your ancestors, all these dimensions of self. Because before we get here, you know, I believe that we're one.
Right.
But that we fragment in this dimension.
Yes.
And so when you fragment, you're going through your life collecting pieces of yourself.
Yes.
And so there's a piece of you that's animal form, a piece of you that's plant form.
Yes.
Piece of you that certain lands, ancestors, certain friend groups, all those are you.
Okay.
You know what I mean? And you're recollecting them.
How do you find your spirit
animal? How do you, like, you know that, like, how
did you realize, like, I know you said, like, your mom was, everybody's calling you bear, but how did you know when you was like, okay, this bear to me?
When I first saw the image where the bear wasn't even in the room, my sister started taking a picture of me, right? She was like, "For some reason, there's this brown blur every time I take this picture of you."
Wow.
And when we printed it out, you know, oh my God, it's a bear. You know what I mean? And that was the final sign where I was like, okay,
yeah,
this is a thing. Mm-hmm. But I think if you're someone who's not really open to that, or someone who doesn't dream, or something like that, or you're just not getting it, what another good thing is to get an oracle that's just animals. And shuffle it just as a start and pull it out and be like, I'm starting with whoever pops up.
Yeah.
Because coincidence is also a way that the universe talks to us as well.
But there are no coincidences.
Exactly.
Because everything is divine intervention.
It's divine intervention.
Because when I started meditating years ago, my first spiritual animal was a dolphin.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a bright blue dolphin, and we used to fly.
Yes.
Like the dolphin flew into the universe.
Yeah.
But when I got stressed and heavy, it turned black.
Mm.
So, yeah, you can definitely, there's various ways, but that is a good way. Because I was going to say, how do you know? And yeah. I do know there's like several yes. different spiritual animals.
And that's the thing I think is so important about the multidimensionality. I'm always pushing multidimensionality. Mm-hmm. Because when you know your animal, you know like, okay, you know that like, okay, I'm feeling sick, maybe I'll throw on my animal shirt. You know what I mean? With that animal. You know? Maybe, but, you know, a lot of us, for example, get stuck when we're depressed or something in our head. Sometimes we get so stuck in, like, affirmations, which are great. Positive affirmations are great. But it's like, what are the other dimensions of yourself that might be sick? If it's rooted in the body,
nice.
Then you're not going to get better. You know what I mean? It's good to know the multidimensionality, because then you can start to say, okay, is the root of the problem here?
Mm-hmm.
Here? Is it in the body? Is it in the emotions? Uh-huh. Is it in the mind? Is it in the spirit?
Right.
You know, where is it? Is it in the coincidences? Yeah. Is it in what dimension is it coming from, and attack it there, as opposed to just being like, oh, I just gotta get through it.
So give me like an example of someone who's trying to use affirmations, but that's not gonna work because they're sick somewhere else. What would you suggest?
This is a great example. Okay. Great. I got some great things. Yeah. So in order for nerves to function properly,
uh-huh.
they have to have a certain amount of oil.
Okay.
You know, so good cooking oils like avocado, you know, grapeseed, things like that are going to be very important.
Is coconut good?
Coconut's good,
okay,
too. Yeah,
okay.
for the firing of the neurons,
okay,
things of that nature.
Mm-hmm.
Also, magnesium is super important.
Oh, yeah, I do a lot of magnesium.
Americans tend to be very magnesium deficient.
Yes.
But they're using positive affirmations, and they're fasting.
Mm-hmm.
But if you're fasting and you're mineral deficient,
yes.
you're not hearing anything. You see what I'm saying?
Yes.
So it's good to know the thing. Another good example. This one's wild. This is mm-hmm. wild. When I was little, I used to have stomach aches sometimes, right?
Oh, okay.
And sometimes I'd be rolling around, oh, a stomach ache. My mom would say, okay, let's go to the doctor. As soon as she say that, I feel better. It just go away. But we'd be in the car, she's like, you better act sick when we get there. You know you're sick. So what happened in that instance? It wasn't really rooted in my body.
What was it?
It was rooted in what I call the story self. I needed a certain story.
Yeah.
I needed to know, Mom, you care about me, that you love me. You're so busy. I just need you to say you're going to do something for
mm-hmm.
me. It's the same type of magic as when, you know, kiss your wound. You know,
mm-hmm.
you know. Sometimes when a child hits their head or falls, they're not really hurting in the body.
Yeah.
They're hurting in their pride or
yeah.
their sense of safety.
I love it.
And you kiss that, hey, go play. You know what I mean? But we call that placebo in the medicine world.
Yes.
The problem is that we have people going to get surgeries
mm-hmm.
when they haven't even tested to see if it was in that realm of the story.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and that's why sometimes we'll go to a shaman or something, and he'll tell you to do something that sounds crazy. Go to the river, jump 9 times, throw 9 coins behind you, and come back and see. To the rational Western mind, that sounds crazy. Like, why would I do that?
Yeah.
But to the subconscious mind,
yes.
A lot of times that stuff will work. You know what I mean?
Sometimes it
works. It'll work. Depending on where it's rooted.
But then they say, oh, that's hoodoo and voodoo and black magic.
Yeah.
But it's not.
Right.
I just have to tell the story because what you said, you know, throw 5 points. So I dealt with a Native American. And he transitioned about 4 or 5 years ago. But art, and I mean, when I say he went to the Sundance every year, he was...
Right.
Native American. I had been divorced, and my ex was stalking me.
Mm.
And I was like, I'm just going to send this wedding ring back to him. He's like, don't you do that.
Mm.
So he tells me to go somewhere into wherever, where there's running water, dig a hole, pour some honey,
mm-hmm.
bury the ring,
yep.
and bless my ex.
That's right.
Now, again, my ex was stalking me for a Mm-hmm. When I did that, we went, my friend and I, because we were devout hikers.
Yeah.
I couldn't even tell you where this trail is.
Yeah.
It was somewhere in Boulder. We went, and she was with me, and I got the little thing. I dug the hole, mm-hmm. and in 48 hours, he was gone.
Yeah.
And it worked.
Yeah, that stuff
works. There's nothing dark about it. It's just a part. I think people fail to realize that we're all connected to nature.
Exactly.
There's no disconnect. When you talked about the fragmentation, we're here.
And,
you can't have one without the other.
And it's also racism. You know, the fact that hoodoo and voodoo and all these things are looked at that way without people even knowing what they are.
Exactly.
It's the same as the word pagan. Pagan just means the religion of the nature people.
Exactly.
You know, hoodoo is when black folks brought over their superstitions, mm-hmm. and the religion was removed from it because they had to become Christian. So what they did was they used the Bible.
The Book of Psalms.
The Book of Psalms. Mm-hmm. They used the Bible, mm-hmm. to represent the stuff they used to do.
Yeah.
So anytime Jesus did something, that was the supreme God they used to use before.
Yeah.
You know, they used it symbolically. Right. Anytime the Israelites won, the slaves won. You know what I'm saying? In the story, so they used that, and that's where there's power in that book.
Yeah.
It's through the symbolism. But that's hoodoo. Most hoodoo people are Christian.
They are. And they use the, I have a book upstairs called the Book of Psalms, yeah. for hoodoo. They use every single Psalm.
They use
like 114 Psalms.
Yes, they have affirmations. They have these scriptures, yep. for if you're sick. These
and
scriptures
money.
For if you're lying.
Money.
Is it money, whatever.
Yeah.
That's hoodoo. Voodoo is an African religion too.
Yes.
It's an African religion that's been demonized.
Mm-hmm.
Why has it been demonized? Because people are afraid of animal sacrifice.
Yes.
But what is it when you're eating at McDonald's?
And you eat a steak.
You eat a steak. A lot of people eat meat. And they're like, well, at least the blood wasn't poured out over some hill or something. And it's like, well, should we not honor the blood? These people don't even eat a lot of meat.
Yeah.
We only believe in blood sacrifice for our greed.
Right.
Because
mm-hmm.
the biggest myth of the Western modern world is secularism.
Yeah.
There's no such thing. Everything has a spirit.
Mm-hmm.
McDonald's has a spirit. Wendy's has a spirit.
Mm-hmm.
America has a spirit.
Right.
This government has a spirit. There's nothing. Oh, I just do this for fun. No, everything is. There's always some spirit being
right.
fed. But we can pretend that we're not doing something spiritual and demonize people that are doing something spiritual. You know, I was watching this thing and they were talking about how in the old African world with some of these animal sacrifices, mm-hmm. it was like, okay, give the blood to the spirit so
mm-hmm.
it wasn't wasted.
Right.
And then we get the meat.
Right.
It's not just
like
some,
halal.
And it's halal.
It's halal. It's the way they kill it.
And
yeah.
Muslims do it.
Yes.
And Jews do
yes.
it.
Yes.
And but since voodoo is such a black thing,
mm-hmm.
you know, that hasn't been absorbed into, that doesn't have that Abrahamic root, there's a lot of racism
yeah.
attached to it. And so it's
and
a
fear.
And there's a fear because mm-hmm. of the movies. There's terrible
yeah.
movies like, first of all, amazing book, Serpent in the Rainbow.
I love
Hollywood.
That was my first. I love that. And that stuff is real. Like,
yeah.
they did. That was based on actual facts.
Yeah.
And it was just a herbal powder.
Did you read the book?
I have not read the book.
Yeah.
But I did. Wait a minute. Did I read the book?
Because the book is.
The book came out first, right?
Yeah.
I might have.
Because the book is good.
Yeah.
The movie, they tried to make it kind of spooky. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And they do that a lot with these movies to demonize voodoo or vodun,
mm-hmm.
but that's a huge part of our story and our power, and it's a religion that deserves respect, just
mm-hmm.
like Ifa, just like
yeah.
Buddhism,
mm-hmm.
just like anything else, but anything black. People, when they talk to me, they say, Monticue, you work with nature and stuff, but you do it like the Native Americans, but not like those black people, right?
What
not like
does
those.
That mean?
Because they think anything black, voodoo, dark, evil,
mm-hmm.
these things all tie in together.
Yeah.
But we don't understand that Vodou, once again, has priests, it has ethics, it has its own thing, just
yeah.
like everything else. So, you know, I'm just a big proponent of getting destigmatizing
right.
the old ways of the bush people and, you know, of ancient Africans.
But
because
everything encompassed, it all can work. Like,
yeah.
there's no one way to do one thing.
Oh, yeah, that's
yeah.
why, and that's why in hoodoo, they could use the Bible, because in the Bible, they're using a lot of the same stuff, too. Blood over the door. And then God all that
yeah.
stuff is in the word. It's
yeah.
in the Bible.
Because it's the Bible
yeah.
that's been tainted.
And we ignore. And we ignore it. And we, you know, and so there's these things. And so, you know, when I talk about multidimensionality,
mm-hmm.
you know, it's a way for us to have more of a spectrum of ways to heal ourselves,
mm-hmm.
as opposed to just getting, you know, getting some symptom and running to the doctor and getting something taken. Because they're quick to cut something off.
Yes.
You know, they're quick to, you know, they're quick
yeah.
to give you some pill that's going to make you, once again, this is all
that,
about
but
history.
That's divinely strategically done because that's how America makes money.
That's how they make the money.
They keep you sick.
Absolutely. So keep, you know, and once again, when I was going back to the Africans that were brought here, you know, another way that the slave masters would try to heal them was through poison pills, you know, pills made out of mercury. Give them that, and they would throw up until they felt better. Mm-hmm. You know, but a lot of people died from that.
Yeah.
Just as much as, you know, there was a lot of Africans were Muslims that were brought over here, too. Mm-hmm. You know, that were dying from pork as well. Like, that's a whole other thing. Yeah. You know what I mean?
But let's talk about some things of nature, because we had this, we skated on this a long time ago.
Yeah.
The trees. Remember I told you? And I seen a video about you on YouTube, on your channel, about trees. Yeah. And when I was saying break up, different time, you know, something told me to go hug trees.
Oh, yeah.
I didn't care. I was walking barefoot, and I couldn't wait to get off work to go walk in City Park barefoot and hug trees. And it wasn't just a tree. It had to be certain trees that called me trees. Let's talk about the trees.
Yeah, let's talk about the trees. Mm-hmm. Because what happens, I don't know if everybody's read this book called The Celestine Prophecy. You read that?
I got that book.
All right. So Celestine Prophecy is so powerful. It's like a game changer.
Mm-hmm.
It's definitely one of my top favorite books.
Yeah.
But one of the reasons I liked it is because it talked about the various ways that we absorb energy from each other.
Yeah.
People that don't have a lot of energy, we're like, you need to pay attention to me. Or, well, oh, boo-hoo, woe is me. And we're just pulling that, you know, in the book, there's this thing where it showed people interacting, and there was... It just showed, like, we make these funnels, and we just suck and suck and suck. The tree has an endless abundance.
Okay.
Due to our lack of connection to the earth and our over-reliance on people around us that are also depleted, that's how we get into some of our worst dramas.
Mm-hmm.
You see? And that's why taking time to hug a tree, which is directly connected to source, directly connected to Mama Nature, giving endless amounts. And remember, the tree, we underestimate the trees because we can kill them. There's this myth that if you can kill it, you're better than it.
Yeah.
But that is silly. Mm-hmm. Because, I mean, I don't think anybody would say, oh, I'm stronger than my grandma because I can push her down the steps. You know, but we see the terminology.
But we tend to have
grandma's carrying the wisdom, carrying the story, carrying all this stuff. And just because you're macho, blah, 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 or you have a chainsaw and can run through this tree with all this wisdom.
Because
the trees are talking. There's a lot of great, resources out now about, even scientifically, they're finally sharing resources through the soil, you know, through the mycelium.
Mm-hmm.
They send electric impulses back and forth. There's stumps that look dead that are still alive because their family are sending energy underneath. Also, as a tree whisperer, I noticed that they'll use the wind to convey messages, you know, through the branches, the same way that we use wind through our vocal cords.
Wow.
You know, you might ask a question or you'll say something prolific and they'll just, you know, all this stuff. But so they have all these powers and they hold all this presence and power and they're solid and they get all their needs met without having to go anywhere. Imagine having it. They're solid.
Yeah.
Meanwhile, we're always losing energy.
Yeah.
Move. Go to a tree. That's the yin to our yang energy. We're humans are very young. We like to do things. We're doing this. Move.
Mm-hmm.
Stop and hug a tree.
Yeah.
And the thing that people will say, they say, well, but I feel like I'm just holding wood. I don't feel.
No.
And I say, okay, well, that's. I say this. I say, look, if you don't feel anything, you have to start with your imagination.
Right.
You know, because some people are naturally.
Or could it just be the wrong tree?
It could be the wrong tree, too. But my point is that through imagining, it starts scratching your intuition if your intuition's not strong.
Right.
And so through that, eventually, you keep going to that same tree and you're imagining something happening.
Mm-hmm.
Something might automatically happen where you're like, oh, another mind opened up.
Yeah.
You know, something where I can feel it. So it's still a good practice, even if you're someone who's, I'm not spiritual, I don't feel anything. Keep doing it and put your heart into it. You have to stop seeing it as a tree. That's another part of the problem is the definition. You know, tree sounds like that thing over there.
Right.
But see it as a spirit.
Yeah.
And wrap your hands around there. Put your fingers in the grooves.
Yes.
And just let yourself pour out into that tree. And you will feel so solid and so healed emotionally. Where when you go home, you don't have to be like, look at me. You know what I mean?
No, it works. I was hugging the tree, and I didn't care who see me. The whole world did not exist outside of me hugging that tree.
Mm-hmm.
And I would walk for at least two or three times around the whole park, barefoot. I had to be barefoot.
Absolutely.
And then I would say, what tree? And I would just hug the tree, and I was crying, and I would talk to me, tell me what to do. So I was like, so fascinated when I seen your videos. Like,
oh, absolutely.
I understand trees, because I think people think I'm a little weird.
But I hey, that's a rabbit hole. Okay, we can go there.
Yeah, let's talk about this.
I want to talk about this little fetish here, because
yes.
This is known as Osayin.
Okay.
Osayin, he's also a deity of the trees in the West African Yoruba
mm-hmm.
tradition. And also, you'll see images like this in the Cuban Santeria, Cuban
mm-hmm.
stuff like that with the religion. And the reason it's powerful is because you notice he has one arm and one leg.
And one eye.
One eye
mm-hmm.
and one ear.
Mm-hmm.
Because he was terribly disfigured
mm-hmm.
through his pride.
Oh.
And but the thing that's powerful about this
mm-hmm.
symbol is that he is represented as the spirit of the herbs, the spirit of herbalism.
Mm-hmm.
Why? Because it is the tree, it is the herb, it is the root, it is all that makes up for our lack of our arm.
Mm-hmm.
It makes up for the symbolic lack of our leg, the symbolic lack of our ear. It is through nature
yes.
that the parts of us as humans that are broken
yeah.
become whole.
Okay.
And so he was once the fastest in all this, and he was still the fastest with one ear, one eye, one
mm-hmm.
arm, and one leg,
mm-hmm.
because whenever he would walk, the tree would become his leg. Whenever he would need an arm, a root would pop out. Whenever he needed that other eye, but he could see through the eyes of nature, the eyes of the trees.
Uh-huh.
He could hear it all. But it's symbolic as well of us, and that's how we have to really dig in
mm-hmm.
and like reclaim nature, because
yeah.
that's where freedom is. That's where our power lies.
Yeah.
Is in nature, and once we do that,
mm-hmm.
we all make up for these missing parts of ourselves.
I'm like speechless. When I was in California when I was little, there's these trees called the weeping willows. They have
mm-hmm.
long, you know, stems. And they said if you speak to them and say nice things, their leaves would spread out.
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't believe it at first, so I couldn't wait to get to the willow. So I was like, oh, I love you, you're so beautiful. And it went like this. And then I said something, you're ugly.
Oh, so
and
you
I,
saw that automatic.
Yeah, I mean, it literally, they were long stems of, you know, leaves called the weeping willow trees. I don't know if they still have them, but I remember it vividly.
Yes,
yeah,
powerful.
Yeah,
these plants, they understand us. They understand
mm-hmm.
us because there's a vibration in the words that carries beyond the word.
And words have power.
They have power. Real power.
People.
That's why self-deprecation is so dangerous.
Are you a Gaia fan? Do you watch Gaia?
I don't, but I was in a commercial for Gaia.
Okay.
I don't know if you ever have you seen it.
I have to look for it. But I was looking at a segment where a lady says, people fail to realize how words have power.
They do.
They can make you or break
yeah.
you. You know?
Yeah.
And
words can also pull you into different paradigms. Talking about like the Western medical industry,
mm-hmm.
they use words to say, this is all there is. There's no cure for this.
Right.
This is all there is.
Mm-hmm.
Let me tell you, they told me 2 years ago that I couldn't walk.
Mm.
You know, because I had arthritis in my knees
mm-hmm.
and the cartilage was gone, and
yeah.
they're like, you're done, you're gonna be in a wheelchair unless you get a knee replacement.
Mm-hmm.
And I believed it for a second, like, oh my God.
Right.
And I was like, wait, let me get out of their words for
yeah.
a second. They didn't tell me anything about how mineral deficient I was. I added silica to
mm-hmm.
my diet,
mm-hmm.
I added magnesium powder. I'm not a fan of pills, okay? So
me too. I have liquids and powders.
Liquids and powders
yes.
only, because they
mm-hmm.
go back to the bloodstream
yeah.
and move fast.
Mm-hmm.
So magnesium, silica, which was also in a herb called horsetail in high abundance.
Yeah.
And then collagen. I added those things to my diet, and all of a sudden, someone threw a frisbee one day, and I ran to catch it, and I was like, I'm ready? What the heck?
I wish I had talked to you before I got my toe surgery, because I had a bone spur, and it was just on a nerve, and it was going up my... I was like, okay. And I pushed it out for a year. I tried it.
Yeah, exactly.
But I didn't... But I was very mineral deficient, so
yeah.
now I'm taking a lot of magnesium.
Absolutely.
I'm taking the... What did you say the other one? Not the
silica. Your collagen?
The collagen.
Yep.
I didn't know about the silica, but...
Yeah.
I mean, so...
Yeah,
silica,
you know, is a precursor for collagen. You know, they don't tell you, like, look, you might be lacking
right.
the ingredients that your body needs to make something. They
the
said, oh, you don't want that?
Money.
Cut it off.
Yeah.
Just cut it off.
Right.
You know, I can't tell you how many stories I have of things where the doctor's like, this is just the way it is. And
mm-hmm.
then you go home and just knock it out. But you have to be able to jump out of that paradigm.
You do.
That's the power. Now, why would I go to the hospital in the first place? It's because sometimes it's good to step out of yourself
and you
to get
to
another angle.
Exactly.
You know what I mean? You know, Dr. Africa, to go back to him, he'd always used to say, you can go to him to get diagnosed, but don't let him treat you. That's what he always used to say.
And that's a good thing, because you do want to know what's wrong with you.
Absolutely.
And
that's why I'm huge on protocol.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I don't think Western medicine is just trash. If,
no,
if you get shot, I'm not going to say, throw this leaf on or bullet wound. I'm not going to do it. You know what I'm saying? But it should not be your first go-to.
Yes.
Especially for something minor or medium.
Yeah.
You know, look in your medicine cabinet. No, look in your kitchen cabinet first.
Yeah.
That doesn't work. You know, go to your grandma. Grandma, do you have any old remedy for that?
Right.
She don't got nothing. Then reach out to your herbalist.
Yeah.
And if that doesn't work, now maybe go to the hospital. But have something in place. You know, and even before that, prayer.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Sometimes all you needed was that prayer. You needed some spirituality.
Because you might have some blockages, you know, that prevents
neurons
and neurons. And something in the nervous system is not connecting to this.
Exactly. And it can manifest in your body.
Exactly. Yes. Question. Let's talk about, I kind of lost my thought, but we started off at the beginning about
the curses?
Yes,
yes,
the curses. Let's talk about the curses.
Mm.
A lot of people ask, are the generational curses real?
Mm.
And if they are, how are they real?
Yeah.
And how do we go about breaking them?
Yeah, generational curses, I mean, they've been proven scientifically, too.
Mm-hmm.
You know.
Like, tell me how they're proven.
Through the epigenetics. You know, the fact that memory can be passed through the DNA,
okay.
And, you know, passed through to your children.
Okay.
If there's any traumas or anything,
mm-hmm.
your kids can show signs of those same traumas, even though they haven't been through it.
Right.
I believe that the experiment, I'm not an expert on this part of it, but I believe that there was an experiment on people that had had children after the Holocaust.
Mm-hmm.
And they found that those children all exhibited signs as if they'd been in the Holocaust.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Things like that. And not even there, like, if we look at our stories, the stories of our families, we can see themes running through these stories.
Yes.
You know, and even my own mother and, you know, her mother and, the, you know, and going back, running away from angry lovers,
mm-hmm.
for example. Everybody running from one angry lover,
mm-hmm.
angry, abusive in some way lover to the next, all the way down
and
to the kids.
And why are they
kids.
Doing that?
What are they running from? You know what
right.
I mean? And that's the thing.
How
and
do you
also,
break that so you're not doing that? Did
yeah.
you ever see Eve by you?
I did.
Do you remember the auntie? They were like, every time she got a new husband,
yeah.
he would die.
Yeah.
Let's talk about that. Like, how do you break these curses?
I honestly think breaking mm-hmm. the curses comes through, first of all, understanding the multidimensionality of us.
Okay.
You know, because I think part of the running is not having an expanded view of yourself.
Right.
You know, once again, if you've been trained, you've been plucked from your culture,
mm-hmm.
plucked from your medicine,
right.
plucked from your God,
mm-hmm.
all these things have been taken from you. We don't have the same resources.
Right.
What we have is what they gave us, a type of religion,
mm-hmm.
a type of science,
right.
and some fear, you know, based upon our upbringing.
Mainly a lot of fear.
And a lot of bad teachings.
Yes.
Like, baby, just follow your heart. You love them. You love them. Stuff like that that gets passed down. Like, a lot of generational curses are also passed through bad wisdom.
Do
not follow your heart. You know what I mean?
Right. Follow your mind.
Follow your mind.
Your intuition. Boundaries. Yes.
It will lie to you because,
mm-hmm.
you know, in the Bible, not that I'm a Bible thumper, but it says the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked.
Mm-hmm.
And that's because, and that's true if you lead with it.
Yes.
People need to earn that sacred heart.
That's right.
But the heart doesn't have it's like a baby. It doesn't really have boundaries like this. It's like, love me, hold me. But like, so you've got to create these steps to make
mm-hmm.
somebody, okay, they passed that test.
Right.
Cool. But just, oh, if you love them, go for it, honey. It's
mm-hmm.
so dangerous because infatuation is like a spell. It's like
it
a
is.
Magic spell.
It is a spell.
Like, you're
a
just
spell.
Drugged off
mm-hmm.
each other, things like that. And even in my own life, even recently, I've run into trouble.
Mm-hmm.
Just with bad knowledge that, or bad ways of thinking that I had to learn the hard way because
mm-hmm.
it wasn't given to me in the right way.
Right.
You know what I mean? Where boundaries were crossed,
mm-hmm.
things happened in ways they weren't supposed to happen. I should have followed a certain protocol.
Right.
But once again, you're showing people these. Oh, that's cute. This is cute.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, that's cute. You're just doing this, and before you know it. Especially if you add pride to it, too,
mm-hmm.
that thinks you deserved it.
Yeah.
You know, since so-and-so's treating me this way, I deserve this, or whatever, you find yourself in some turmoil.
Right.
And so, but But bad knowledge has to be cut. We have to start saying, hey, kids, this is what's really... Because I can't tell you how many older folks I've gone to, like, tell me, how'd y'all make it? Just the Lord, baby.
Terrible knowledge.
Communication. Yeah. You know, good communication. And we stuck it in.
Yeah.
You know, it's deeper than
it's
that.
It's like, where's the... When are we going to have systems in place that are just as intricate as business school?
Exactly.
You know, for us,
the
you know, coming up.
Courting.
The art of courting, you know, the right and wrong way of doing these things. But it's but in American society, there's so many realms of thinking that you can find an excuse to do whatever you want on Google.
Oh, wait. No.
Easy. You know
what
I mean?
The one that says, to get over old love, you put it on, get up
and yeah, exactly.
And
yeah.
I'm like, you didn't even have time to heal.
And that is...
You didn't even close this door.
Exactly.
And all you're doing is creating this snowball effect for you to, you know, burn and crash.
Yeah, and that's the generational curse right there.
Okay. So it's just the thoughts and...
It's the thoughts, it's the culture you pass down.
The bad words of wisdom.
Yes, the bad words of wisdom. And also I think, you know, you got to add some spirituality in there. You know, it's like, what kind of spiritual are you connected to?
Yeah.
You know, like in Ifa, which is one of the traditions that I work with, you know, we have something called Odu. And Odu is like a sign or symbol you get at birth or when you become initiated.
Yes, yes.
Or pre-initiated.
Yeah.
And it has this list of things. Do not do this.
Yeah, don't eat this.
Don't eat this.
Yes,
yeah.
Yes, my friend is into that.
Yeah.
I've been to several of them.
And it's pretty cool because, you know, like, it at least gives you some starting points of, like, maybe I should watch out for that. Not that it's true, but that it will be...
It'll be a guideline.
It'll be revealed through your life. Oh, that's why I said not to eat that. Oh, that's why I shouldn't do this. Or that's why I shouldn't be in love triangles. Or whatever it is, you start to learn the hard way. Like, okay, and it pulls you that way. But even outside of that, even if you're just a Christian or a Muslim, follow your rules.
Exactly.
Because
if you don't follow the rules, then you have to deal with the consequences.
Yes.
And there's no good or bad. It's just the consequences.
And the consequences can hurt.
Yeah.
They can hurt.
Trust me, I know.
Yeah. I'm heartbroken right now.
Oh.
But I guarantee you that I will not make the same mistake again. And that is a powerful thing. Because there's this whole thing right now around F-boys. I don't know if you've heard a lot about F-boys.
The fuck-boys?
F-boys, yeah.
Yeah, this is my channel.
Okay, cool. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
And there's this new thing called the spiritual fuck-boy. You know,
they're trying to act like,
yeah, girl, I'm so conscious, I'm woke.
Hey,
baby, let's go meditate. And then but the wisdom in that is that all of us are that.
Yeah.
Sometimes.
Yeah.
Because you don't always know you're harming someone. You think you're being so smooth. Mm-hmm. You think you're someone's teacher. Mm-hmm. You think you're doing this. And then when certain boundaries get crossed and you're like, oh my God, I'm doing this thing. I didn't know I could do that.
Right.
You had to fall into that to know that you were capable of breaking that. You know what I mean? Like, sometimes, like...
We have a shadow side.
Exactly.
And we can't pretend like we don't have a shadow
right.
side. Because I know I've come face to face. And I'm okay with it.
Right.
I have no qualms or qualms about my shadow
side. But what's the wisdom in the shadow side is that it shows you where you need accountability.
Yes.
You know, if you know that you're an alcoholic, for example, or if you know that you're addicted to certain drugs, you shouldn't be there. You know what I mean? You need to be around people all the time that are like,
yes.
Oh, we ain't going to go drink. We're going to the movies. We're
exactly.
going to hold you accountable. Because you know once it's in your system or you know once it's there, you're going to do
it. Open up doors.
It's part of what we call osokbos. It's your taboo. It's something that will throw you off balance.
Right.
If you know you're going to start flirting with the sister, you know what I'm saying, but you're with somebody, and you need to start bringing your wife with you everywhere you go.
Yep.
Or you need to make sure if you know how bad it is because you've been scarred, as soon as that flirt starts, you know what I'm saying, cut it off.
Yeah,
I'm not giving you no hope. Because maybe you have the power to suck me in if that's a weakness.
Right.
You know what I mean? But just knowing your weak spots, something eventually, I always tell my kids, like, I'm like, you're lucky I caught you before the world did.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Right.
Because, sure, you mad because I took your phone away. You know what I'm saying? If you did that out in the world,
right.
You might be in jail or you might be you know, homeless or you might be something else. You want me to catch all these things.
Exactly.
And the same goes for us, even as adults,
right.
Is we want the little slap on the wrist, you know,
from
whatever happens.
Because I don't want to say
you can get away with stuff for so long before the crash happens.
Yes.
But sometimes the crash has to happen.
Right.
I was talking to you earlier just about the scar.
Yeah, let's talk about that.
You know, and the scar, you know, I have a really good friend who talked about, you know, infidelity and things like that, mm-hmm. and how he was so heartbroken of all the things he had to lose, his reputation and everything mm-hmm. around this, that it created a scar on his heart to mm-hmm. where he was never able to
love again.
He was never able to commit the same crime again mm-hmm. because that scar would start hurting. You know, you would remember. Remember yeah. what happened last time? Do you want to lose your wife?
Right.
Do you want to? You have kids. You have a house. You want to lose that?
Yeah.
No, I don't. I've done it before.
Right.
And the weight of the scar carried more than the temptation. Mm. You see, because
so that was a break of that generation's curse because old patterns.
Yes, because in America we tend to be very pleasure based. And we're like, oh, if you want it, if it tastes good, oh, if it feels, go get it. It's yeah. yours. You can have whatever
instant
you want.
Gratification.
Negative. Yeah. You have a path. You have to know why you were born. Mm-hmm. You might not be here on vacation. If you have a purpose-driven life and you're sent here to mm-hmm. make stuff happen, you're here on work duty.
Right.
And so there's certain things you have to do, or bad luck is going to be everywhere.
Do you feel like if some people don't find their purpose, that they keep coming back?
Yes.
Because I yes. know I was told, well, I had a poem read, and he told me things that I was like, whoa.
People are gifted, bro.
That I'm living out now. Even with you, you've read some of my cards that it's unfolding now. But I had, I don't know if you ever heard of this song by Tina Marie called Deja Vu.
Sing it for me. I'm just kidding.
I'm young and I'm old. I'm rich and I'm poor. It's been so many times I've been here before. Once I was a wise man on a horseback running free, searching in the darkness for a piece of me. And something. I've been here before. I'll let you hear it. But I used to hear the song a lot, and I was like, I used to just cry because I was like, you know, I've been here before, and I need to know what I want to do, because I was like, I don't want to come back. Mm. I do not. When I leave this time, I do not want to come
back. You don't
want
to come back. But you know what you can come back to.
I don't want to come back. Take me to another universe, but I don't want to come back. And I hear that song, and she had said she had been here, and she was talking about, this is the last time I'm coming back. Mm. And she was talking about, like, if you don't do the right thing, you're going to have to come back. If you don't treat people right, you're going to come back. And so I'm thinking, you know, a lot of people, they do have a purpose, and sometimes they don't find their purpose.
Yeah.
And I'm wondering, it's like, sometimes, you know, people, like, I see, you know, people are homeless or on drugs or, you know, even a child coming in here, and they get cancer, and they die at such a young ages. Did you? Because they talk about you choose. That was your purpose, to choose that.
Yeah.
Do you believe that?
I think there's levels to it. You know, I believe there's personal karma, but there's also group karma.
Okay.
And so personally, I do think that there's certain things we can't escape.
Okay.
You can't just say, I'm a goddess, I'm going to go get what I want. Okay. No. Mm-hmm. Your duty is to find out why you're here.
Right.
Not what you want.
Right.
You know, they don't always correlate.
Right.
You know, so-and-so can be a player Mac Daddy all he wants. Montague cannot. If I be a player Mac Daddy, I'm going to lose all of it. I have so much evidence to prove it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Well, they've been doing their thing for 20 years.
Yeah.
30 years. Because the path is different. They have a different assignment.
Yeah.
You see what I'm saying? Now, as far as group karma, some of that's going to be the weight that is placed upon that country.
Right.
You see what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Because they are committing a crime that's affecting the purpose of someone else.
Yeah.
So I believe that we have our own thing, but we're not in a bubble.
Yeah.
My story can rub off on your story. Mm-hmm. And then, as far as group, the country can be set up in a way where, because this country, the way things have been set up is to squelch our purpose.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
It's to squelch it. Keep us programmed. Absolutely. I mean, they got all of this technology. Yep. People don't even read anymore.
Yeah.
Like, I like a book.
Yeah.
You know, people can't even remember numbers. You remember when you were young, you remember everybody in your mom's house, their numbers. I only know four.
Yeah.
It's pretty bad.
And so it's you know, that's why you get books like The Fall of America. All this stuff.
Yeah.
It's going to be burning. Those are people that know the karma of the country because of what it's doing to God's people.
Mm-hmm.
You know, God gave these people this purpose, and you're squelching it. You know, people. Some people are homeless that weren't meant to be homeless. But even in that homelessness, that person still has the power to push out some of
to uplift themselves.
I'm not saying they'll be rich. I'm not saying this. They might just be the leader of their little homeless crew.
Exactly.
But they can still show, you know, leadership and make an impact. Right. You can lead from wherever you're at.
Right.
So there, it's both. It's your personal experience, but also you're collecting your experience, the group karma of where you incarnated as well. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? And so knowing that will help you to kind of move through life, I believe, in a more peaceful way. Mm-hmm. Being honest when something is repeatedly bad for you.
Okay.
You know what I mean? But also connecting your karma, connecting your group karma with people you think can lift you up. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And keep, that's that accountability piece. That's also just that finding where you fit. Like, you know, what piece, everybody needs a team.
So I want you to tell the audience, what do you think they should know to help get them on the path to living a purpose-driven life? Tell our audience right over there.
To get on the path of a purpose-driven life, I believe it first of all starts with your spirituality. I'm a very spiritual person, and so if you're an Ifa, follow your old dude. If you're a Christian, follow that Bible. If you're a Muslim, follow that. Follow those first and be as religious as you can. I'm a big, I believe in being what you say you are.
Yes.
Number one. The second thing is be nice to yourself.
Mm-hmm.
You will fail. Just because you have the blueprint doesn't mean you're not going to sometimes test it. And see if it's real, and see if you'll really be punished for these things, you know? So I believe through having a code and then being honest about results are the first two steps. The next is a team, accountability. You gotta have a team, and you have to be humble with that team. You have to be without pride, because pride always leads before destruction. Anytime you see these big cult leaders, and it's like, oh man, the cult leader is with all the women in the cult, or, you know, or start touching kids. Where does that start? That starts from pride.
Mm-hmm.
I deserve this because I'm the king, I'm the god of this and that. You know what I mean? And so if you can avert pride, you know, then you, in your humility, can assess and grow. And so just continue to live. Also, do your herbs. Plants hold wisdom. You know, find your power animal. You know, locate the herbs that are really touching you in a major way, that it might have come through your ancestry. It might be stuff that grows around you, but get into some herbal teas. You know, on top of that, get your magnesium powder. I'm a huge fan of that, you know. And also, I think that having a guide is very important, having a role model.
Mm-hmm.
You know, this is a lot of things, but, you know, but having a role model of some sort, or tracking with someone. You know, for folks that want to track with me, you can go to my Patreon,
mm-hmm.
you
tell
know,
your social media
at patreon.com mm-hmm. / A Root Awakening. It's all one word, A Root Awakening, instead of A Root Awakening.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's one place you can find me. You can find me as Monticue Connally on Facebook,
mm-hmm.
Monticue_TheHerbalist in Instagram. So those are some ways you can reach me, but...
Mm-hmm.
YouTube channels, African American Shaman
okay.
is the YouTube channel.
Okay.
And so I'm still learning on those platforms. Oh, my TikTok.
Oh, you got a TikTok?
My TikTok is popping.
Okay.
You know, it's a lot of information on my TikTok.
Okay.
It's probably my biggest, you know, it's been my favorite hobby right now. Because
uh-huh.
I didn't even know people want spiritual wisdom on TikTok.
Uh-huh.
You know, but yeah, my TikTok.
Uh-huh.
Is pretty popular right now. It's called A Root Awakening as well.
Oh, you gotta help me with TikTok, because I ain't.
Yeah, I think you would like TikTok. Let me see.
Have you got TikTok?
I do.
What's
got
going
TikTok.
On that?
Let me see. I'm trying to make sure I gave you the right name.
Okay.
Yeah, so it's @A_root_awakening, but awakening is spelled AW8KENING.
And we're going to have all of his social medias right down below.
Yeah.
So that you can follow him everywhere. So I just want to say, Monticue, it has been a pleasure. There's so much we can talk about.
Absolutely.
I can talk to you all day.
Thank you.
I definitely want to come bring you back for season two.
Thank you.
And we can pick a very detailed subject and just dive in
deep.
And, you know, go deep. But I'm so honored you came here. I was, like, super nervous. But you have given us so much information. I want to thank the Valor family for joining us. Thank you so much. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Please let us know what your thoughts, your comments below. Let us know, what do you think about this beautiful, beautiful spiritual being? Remember to live authentically and live with valor. In the meantime, until next time, see you at the top, because the bottom is too close.